So welcome everybody to today's webinar on the topic of using remote access to identify and solve customer issues in field devices. We are very excited for this one and we hope you are also. But before we start, just a few technicalities. First thing is you will see a chat on your on the webinar tool there, and you can use that to let us know in case you have any technical troubles or you want to warn us about something. We will also have a dedicated slot in the end for questions. And during the presentation, you can use the chat to ask your questions, and our team is monitoring the chat. And at the end, they will organize everything and make these questions available. You can, of course, ask them when we reach the dedicated slot for the questions. And the last thing, we are also recording this webinar, and it will be made available in about a week or so on Toradex websites. So let's go ahead and get started. Before we dive into the content, just a few presentations. My name is Lucas. I am Product Marketing Manager for Toradex with the products team. And together with me here, I have Stefano. He's a software architect for Toradex, and he's leading the engineering group for Torizon. Briefly going over the agenda, we will start with a short introduction about Toradex and Torizon, just to make sure everybody has the same context. Then we jump straight into a demo, I believe the most exciting part there, showing about how we handle devices that are error in production and how we go about troubleshooting them. Talk a little bit about Torizon and security, and then going also a little bit more in depth on the remote access feature and security. Security is one of the key aspects of Torizon for us. And then compare a little bit our remote access solution with other offerings that are available on the market. And lastly, Stefano will show you some cool features that you can do with remote access that go further than a simple SSH session. And then, as I mentioned, we have a dedicated questions and answers slot at the end. So starting off, Toradex, I believe most of you already know, but what we do is make embedded systems easy, right? And we do this at a hardware and at a software level. On the hardware level, we have our system on modules. We expose the SoC's interfaces on a nice connector to use, and then you can create your customized board there and use these interfaces as you wish. So it's kind of a nice abstraction between a single board computer and developing your own board from scratch. Reliability is top of mind for us. This is what most people identify Toradex with, and we are definitely very proud of that. On the software level, we do have a fully integrated Linux IoT platform, which is Torizon. We will get, of course, more into that as the webinar progresses. And our goal there with all of this is to make your total cost of ownership the lowest possible. Cost of ownership, we define it as the cost that you have when you start developing a product up until it phases out from the markets. So this includes development, maintenance, and everything in between. And our hardware and software offerings aim to make that the lowest possible. Technical support is also something that most people associate Toradex with. As you can see on the map on the right side here, we are present in various corners of the world, so it's very likely that you have someone speaking our language or on the same time zone as you are. So this is also very nice for Toradex. And the last thing, but not less important, we have an extensive partner network that they can help you with hardware development, with software development. It's very likely that if you have some sort of lacking of ability in your company, we most likely have a partner that can help you with that. Our typical applications, again, on Toradex side, our top five verticals is industrial automation, healthcare, transportation, test and measurement, and smart cities. And these are all verticals that really need to have this top reliability. Things really cannot go wrong when you are in these verticals. So this is why Toradex is very strong in them. And I also bring back the topic of the webinar, remote access. These are also verticals that people can really benefit from remote access, and we see people using it already. So having your devices, kind of the safety net behind your devices in the field that you can easily go there and troubleshoot fast, really brings a lot of value to, especially in this critical verticals here, right? Our typical volumes per project on a system on modules case is about 100 to 50K pieces per year. This is where system on modules really shine, right? Their benefits really shine. So this is where Toradex is mostly present in. Our hardware portfolio, going over very quickly, we have quite a few system on modules. Most of them are NXP based. We are just launching our Verdin AM62. Based on the TIAM62 SoC there, so we are very excited for that. But for this webinar, we want to talk mostly about software. Now getting into Torizon a little bit, I believe majority of you may be familiar with Torizon, but Torizon is our tool or our set of tools that simplifies the development and the operation of Linux IoT devices there. So we really like this diagram. On the top left there, you can see kind of the development side, the development cycles. So the developers really leverage our tools that we provide, both on the OS and on the application layer. On the OS, we provide nightlies, monthlies, and quarterlies production-ready builds. We call our OS Torizon Core. And we also offer tools to customize Torizon Core, the OS again. Without having to go through Yocto or any of that. If you want to, you can also do that. But we do have quite some people that are not very fond of Yocto. And with our tools, you can customize it, do a lot of cool things without going into Yocto. And also, of course, leveraging our quarterly production-ready builds. On the application layer, we use Docker on Torizon Core, and we provide a bunch of ready-to-use containers. We have hardware accelerated things for GUIs, for machine learning. So you have that also from the get-go. Then on the bottom center there, we have the monitoring part. So not only you have to develop your products, but also you have to maintain them. And then this integrates nicely with the Torizon platform here in the center. The Torizon platform allows you to connect to your devices in the field in a very secure way. To deploy OTA updates, to monitor the health of your devices in the field, and of course, to remote access them in case you need to do something in this more urgent matter. Torizon Core, we are not that interested in Torizon Core here, but it does allow you to go faster to markets. As I mentioned, it's a ready-to-use operating system that integrates nicely with the Torizon platform and with all of the development tools that we provide for Torizon. It's open source, so there's really no lock-in there. The OTA updates also supports out of the box. Integrates very nicely with our hardware. It's made for our hardware. Security, we will get a lot more in-depth on security on this webinar, but yeah, it's the topmost priority for Torizon security, and we also have a real-time option there for Torizon Core. Cool. Now we get into the topic at hand, which is troubleshooting devices in the field, right? And we wanted to start this off with a very short poll to try and understand what are your biggest pain points when troubleshooting field devices. So I will launch the poll here. It's very important that you all engage. It's very cool. We will see the results later, and we can take a look there and on what you feel like is the biggest issues. We have the end customer having a bad experience. So this happens because of takes a lot of time to understand what the issue is, or the communication-based troubleshooting. Like if your support team doesn't have visibility on the system, they have to call the customer and try to understand what's going on. And this can be very annoying for everybody. Costs, right? So sometimes you need to send technicians to the field, or you need to ship the product that is showing errors back to your development benches, or deploying the fix at the end there after you find out what's wrong. Cool. So we have answers coming in. Pretty tight competition. We have most people voting already, so I'll go ahead and close it and share the results with you. Okay, So as you can see, it's a pretty tight competition. We have quite some people mentioning the communication problem, right? You often have to rely on your customers saying what's wrong about the product, and this can lead to inefficient communication. The second there is deploying the fix. So once you fix it, you need some way to deploy it. And then, of course, people, not less important, the end customer having a bad experience, and also the overall costs. Thank you for the participation. This is very nice results and leads in nicely with our next slide here that just covers up how troubleshooting in production feels today without having a proper tool to do that, right? So the first problem there is that errors only come up after the customers notice them. So if you don't have visibility on your system, if you don't have a good way to measure the health of your system remotely and automatically, the errors only come up after you get like a customer call saying that things are breaking or things are slow. There's probably some issue there, and this leads to bad customer experience. Once you find out that there is an error, the support and the troubleshooting also take a long time because it's often based on like trial and error. You have to ask on the phone with your customer, what are you seeing on the screen? Or can you do that for me? Can you try this? So the communication ends up taking a lot of time. It also ends up being very expensive. Sometimes people need to move around, or the product needs to be transported back to your bench. And then the last point there is the deployment of the fix. Once you find it and fix it, it is slow and can be error prone if you don't have a good tool or a good process for that. The good thing is with Torizon, all of these issues are solved. So on the first part there, identifying that something is wrong with your device, Torizon offers device monitoring, which is a way to measure the health of your devices in production. So you can understand when something is wrong without needing to rely on your customer to tell you, which leads to bad experience again. Once you find out that something is wrong, you can use remote access, which we are going to show today here, to troubleshoot and really understand why that thing is happening, why the problem is occurring, and what makes it occur. And then there's, of course, an important step there, which is fix the problem. But there's really no way to hack that. And then the last step is to deploy the solution, and Torizon offers the OTA updates feature that really helps you to do that. So you come from a slow, a prone to errors, and inaccurate and expensive experience, and then it kind of becomes fast. You have instant visibility of the system, it's accurate, and it's much more inexpensive there. Before we jump into the demo, I just wanted to contextualize everybody on what you will be seeing. This on the left here, I have a set of videos that shortly show how using the Torizon platform feels like. And it will be clear these three steps. So figuring out something is wrong, using remote access to troubleshoot it, and then deploying the solution via OTA updates. So it makes sense to start with device monitoring. On the right side here again, you see a video on how it feels like. Here we are on a device page, and you can see all sorts of metrics. The metrics that are shown here on the video are metrics that come out of the box. So on a fresh Torizon Core installation, you will get these metrics as soon as you turn on the device. But the cool thing is that you can easily customize these metrics to show what you really want. So you can do all sorts of cool things. And on the demo, you will see that I added a custom metric here that measures how many runtime errors I had in my application. So ideally, you want to see that on zero, right? But if you see a big spike, like on a fleet level or on a device level, it's very likely that something is wrong and you should take action before your customer notices it. Once we find out that something is wrong, we move on to remote access. So again, I have a demo video here just showing how it feels like. With remote access, you can create a secure tunnel, a secure TCP tunnel to your device, and you can simply log in using SSH. You end up on a shell there on your device, fully secure, of course, and on your field devices, just making sure that that's clear. So once you land up here, you can use the tools that you're familiar with, like the masks. You can read the logs. You can fetch the journals, read the application logs, all sorts of stuff to understand what the problem is, the problem that you found on the last step. And then again, there is a step missing here that is develop your fix, right? Not a simple step, but not really pertaining here to the platform. The idea here is that we want to deploy that to our few devices in a secure way. And Torizon, of course, helps you to do that with our OTA updates. So this is what you see. You select the package that you want. This can be an OS package, an application package. It goes as low also as a bootloader package, so you can update the bootloader, and also external devices like the Cortex-M4, for example, is pretty common to update the firmware for that. And the good thing there is that is a fully reliable update. So in case the update fails, either because there was like a network issue and then the download stopped for some reason, we timed out, or the power supply got cut and the device shut down mid-update before the update complete, it will roll back to the previously working version. Or even if the update goes through, but the package itself is a bad software, right? Like it's an OS that doesn't boot or something like that, then it also rolls back. And with that, we are ready to move on to the demo. We call this demo My Devices Are Experiencing Errors in Production. Our story here, we have a simple story. We have an IoT climate sensor kit. You can think of it as a small product that we leave in various parts of the world. So it's a very distributed product. And it contains various climate sensors. It measures all sorts of things like humidity, temperature, pressure, again, on various points of the world so that we can track that. It sends this data to a remote IoT infrastructure so that we can, of course, see this data and understand what's going on. It also offers a display, a simple user interface where local users or technicians can go there and read the measurements for themselves. And the last point there is it logs all of the sensor data in a USB stick, in a removable drive, so that people can remove it and analyze the data for whatever purpose they want in a local manner. So I will go ahead and move on to our Torizon platform here. I have here on my fleet management, I have a production fleet. So I just have 8 devices just to exemplify how it feels like. And the good thing about Torizon is that on the fleet view, so I have my 8 devices here, we offer the device monitoring at a fleet level as well. So here I'm taking a look at my fleets. Just go ahead and update the timing there. So you can see here at a fleet level, the memory usage, the CPU usage, the CPU temperature, and the runtime errors here. As I mentioned, it's the custom metric that I added. And unfortunately, our devices are erroring a lot. So we are counting a lot of runtime errors there. So it's very likely that something is wrong. This view, it shows you, like you have a fleet, say you have a fleet of 100 devices. It will show you kind of the average for all devices, the max, the minimum. But we also offer this very cool feature. It's hidden away in this little button, which is called Outliers. If you click this, you can view what devices are kind of dissonant from the rest of the fleet, right? So I have these devices, which is showing all of the errors. So the tool identifies this for me and lets me know that this is the device that is issuing all of the errors. So let's go ahead and go to the device page. Let's just double check that this is indeed the case. So here I'm on the device page. You can see what software is running on the OS, on the application, and you can see also the metrics for this specific device. And as you can see here, the device is counting a lot of errors. So definitely something is wrong and you should understand what's wrong. It's very easy to start a remote troubleshooting session. You just click here. Before I do that, I just want to show the setup briefly. On your account, I have this tab here, Remote Access Manager, and the way that it goes through about it, Stefano will get a lot into more details on the security aspect, but if you've ever used GitHub or something like it, you should be familiar. You generate an SSH key pair, and then you just post here your public key, give it a friendly name, and then it will show up here on the list. I have already done this, so I should be good. So let me go ahead and go back to my device there, the device page. Okay, so this is the one that's showing errors. Let's go ahead and start a remote shell. So I'll click here. Here you can set the timeout for the session. So this, as soon as I click initiate session, this will open a security CP tunnel to my device. And I can set for how long I want this tunnel to be open. I will just leave it some random value here. So I'll initiate the session. And then in here, it gives you the command that you need to run to access your device. And just to reiterate, this is a device that's out there in the field. So I don't have direct access to it. Stefano, again, will go a little bit more in depth from the security aspect there. But the device doesn't need to have any open ports. Even if it's behind a firewall, it still works okay, and he will discuss it. So I copied the command there. I'll go ahead and paste here on my terminal. Now Windows offers the SSH tool out of the box, which is very cool. Cool. Now I'm logged in on the device here. It's very simple, very straightforward, and we can go ahead and run all sorts of tools here to troubleshoot it. We can run DMASC, whatever you want to run, it should work okay. Since I created this metric myself, I know that I'm counting the number of errors in my application logs. So if we go ahead and take a look, my application here is running. So just as a side note, if you're not that familiar with Docker, it's okay. There are other ways to develop application in Torizon, but let's stick here to the demo on Docker. So I would read the logs on my application, and okay, so it keeps, apparently, if we read there, file not found, no such file or directory, and then this is the main drive, right? So it's not able to find the file there to write on. This would be, if you remember our product architecture there, this would be the file that the product would write on, the external USB drive. So it's not there. The probability is it's not correctly inserted on the USB port, or maybe a technician removed it to read the logs. And unfortunately, our developer here did not treat this case accordingly. So the application panics and quits, which is definitely not good. So we understand the issue here. Should be a simple enough fix. I won't do the actual fix and the uploading of the new application package, but I will show you how the OTA feels like. So let's suppose that our developers added a new line that first checks if the USB is correctly plugged in, the file is there. And then they upload the application package here to our platform. It's very straightforward to do, but I have done this already. You just come here, initiate updates. The type of update is an application, so it's a Docker Compose file that we want to update. And the device was running the untreated version, so the version that doesn't check first if the USB is there, but I want to update to the treated version. So I'll just hit continue. I will trigger the update, and then it's assigned. In about 3 to 5 minutes, the device will be running this new version, all transparent to you. All should be working okay, and then as soon as the update is completed, again it takes like 3 to 5 minutes, we should see this graph here drop to zero ideally. I won't wait this time because we are very short on time. I will just go ahead and keep the application moving, but I hope you were able to get a grasp on how it feels to use it, and basically what the feature is capable of doing. It's a very powerful feature, and Stefano will go even more in depth on what it can do. So just reiterating, life before remote access, kind of exaggerate here a little bit, but it's good to look at it this way. It would depend on your customers calling your support team to report an issue. Then the support team needs to go back and forth to figure out what's wrong. Communication takes a long time. Everyone suffers. Everyone is sad and disappointed. And this is a very expensive process. After remote access, you can preemptively find out the issue. You instantly get visibility on the device, SSH. This is something that Stefano will show. You can see what your customer is seeing on the front end, on the display via VNC. It's also supported. He will show a little demo there. The issue is quickly found, and then after it's developed, the deployment is pretty painless and quick. So, setting it up, now going a little bit more on the feature itself. It's built in. On the device side, it's built in this feature with Torizon Core version 6.3 or after. When you're in development, you can just flash the newest Torizon Core there on your board, and you can manually enable it, enable the remote access service there. But when you're in production, we recommend using Torizon Core Builder. It's that tool that I talked about before that allows you to customize Torizon Core without needing to go to Octo, and you can enable the service there. As I showed on the website, you can generate an SSH key pair on your host machine, and then you upload the public key to Torizon.io, and that's pretty much it. The setup part is pretty simple. And I highlighted here as well that there is no IT setup needed, no fancy firewall, port forwarding, opening up ports. None of that is really necessary. The typical use cases, as I mentioned, providing customer support and troubleshooting devices with errors. Remote actions is also something that we see often. So if you if the device is for some reason behaving strangely and you just want to reboot it, you can use this to reboot it. You just create a new session, go there and reboot the board. And also fetching logs, as I mentioned, and as I showed on the demo, is also one of the most typical use cases there. And this is for production devices, but Torizon can also help you greatly during development. We put some use cases here. So if you have distributed teams kind of working on the same device, they can use it. They can remote debug the device. So if the device is being developed in one country, but another developer wants to debug it on another, you can do that. GDB is a supported use case here. And it also allows you to deploy your pilot runs and iterate fast, having this safety net on the back of your mind that if something goes wrong, you can go there with remote access and quickly understand it and quickly fix it. Last point from my side, it's easily integrated into your own workflows. So you can do all of these operations through our API. You can open the tunnels through our API and you don't have to worry about the security. We handle all of that for you. You can use this to, for example, create custom actions for non-technical people. So if you have a customer success team that may not be very familiar with SSH or something like that, you can use the API to, for example, create a dashboard for them with some buttons. And then like one button says, reboot the entire fleet or reboot some device or fetch some logs from some device. Then you can use the Torizon API to do that in a fully automatic way and automate all of these processes. Stefano, we get a little bit more on about this, but this, as I mentioned before, it's just a plain TCP tunnel. So it allows for great flexibility. You can use all sorts of protocols there, TCP-based protocols. And you don't need to worry about like servers and any of that. Toradex hosts all of that for you and makes it available for you. With that, I would like to pass on to my colleague, Stefano. He will go more in depth about the security aspects and even more in depth on some of the other features that remote access enables you to have. So Stefano, take it away. Thank you for your time.
Yes. Thank you very much, Lucas. So let's go deep in the architecture and security of this amazing feature. But before we go on, let me start a new poll here. Okay, so how important it is to have a secure and a compliant infrastructure to access your product in the field? We have many options. Very important, my product has to be compliant with the cybersecurity. Important, I want to secure my end customer experience. Not very important, but nice to have. My device is completely offline. I will leave you some time to participate, just to collect some data and see what we can get as a result. Let's just order a few 5 seconds. Okay, I think we can close it. Let me share the result. Okay, so seems that is very important, especially because you need to be compliant with the cybersecurity regulation. Okay, here we go. Lucas showed in his demo how remote access works for, you know, from the user's point of view, emphasizing that it's really easy to use. But what really happened behind the scene? So with this animation here, that you should be able to see, should help us easily understand what is going on when a user starts a remote access session. As you can see on the left side, there is what represents an hypothetical product with one of our device on board. Inside that device is installed the Torizon Core operating system, our Yocto-based Linux distribution that Lucas already talked about, that integrates out of the box the remote access client. This remote access client is in contact with one of our service called the remote access service. And when it receives a new remote access request, it performs all the necessary and security check, receiving and validating the obtained metadata that in a moment we will see what means, after which it starts a secure SSH tunnel to our server. Then when this step it's completed, the user basically will be able to able and safely start a secure SSH connection to the device. Okay, but let's try to go into a little more detail. As maybe many people here in the audience already know, in Torizon, we support the Uptain framework. For those who may not be familiar with it, I recommend that you refer the official page. Here I will send the link in the chat. Yes. Summarizing and simplifying, we can say that Uptain is a comprehensive standard that focuses on secure and reliable software update, particularly in safety critical industries like automotive. It aims to prevent tampering and ensure the authenticity and integrity of software updates, which is vital for the safety and functionality of modern connected systems like an industrial IoT product, for example. But how does Uptain come into play and what we can achieve with it? We defined basically a new role for the remote access feature, which derives its authority from the Uptain Director Router of Trust. This role is responsible for deciding which SSH key devices should accept for remote session. Like everything in Uptain related, you can either keep your key online with us, or you can make them offline. If the key for this role are offline, you have an extra protection against various type of attack. For example, as we have here also in the slide, if someone were to gain a full access of your repository, they will be not able to add their own SSH key to the authorized list. So they wouldn't be able to actually connect to your device. Basically, we are able to support what is called the zero trust model. In addition, this type of architecture leads us to be almost ready for the European Cyber Resilience Act and related coming cybersecurity regulation. Yeah, one thing to go into even more details, Our remote access implementation has several advantages over competing implementation that allow us really to stand out. This is a list of the most important one that you can see here in the slide, but let's see one by one in detail. So the first one, extensive metadata validation. The Torizon remote access client perform much more validation of metadata received from the server than other clients. This means that the information received from the server is truly checked for authenticity and integrity before being accepted. This reduces the risk of accepting malicious data. Strict authorization process. The remote access clients employs different validation that all must pass for a session to be authorized. It doesn't just trust a payload from a server, making sure that multiple security checks are in place before granting the access session really rides the level of security. HTTPS certificate pinning. Our remote access client only accept a specific pinned HTTPS certificate. By pinning the certificate, the client ensures that it only communicates with authorized server, preventing potential man-in-the-middle attack. Mutual TLS authentication. Our client requires the device to authenticate using TLS before obtaining a session metadata from the server. This ensures that the client and the server both verify each other's identities, adding an extra layer of security to the communication. Metadata signing. The metadata received from the server is signed. As I said before, you can even sign with your offline key, with additional layer of security using the obtain protocols. This feature ensures the integrity and authenticity of the metadata. User-controlled session initiation. The session is only opened when the user chooses to do so, giving the user more control of when and how remote access is initiated. It's not like other solutions that, for example, always keep a channel on. Session timeout and server control. The server can actually enforce session timeout, as also Luca showed, which means that idle session will be automatically closed after a specific period of inactivity, reducing the risk of unauthorized access. Mature SSH server implementation. Basically, our remote access client use a mature implementation of SSH server running on the client side. This implementation undergoes regular security review and updates to mitigate potential vulnerabilities. So this is why it's really a good choice to use as a tunnel technology. Last but not least, there is the privilege limitation. In the default settings, the remote access client running a separate SSH server as an unprivileged user in our Torizon core operating system. This minimizes the potential damage that could be caused by a successful exploit of, you know, SSH server. But not only, we also use a dedicated secure SSH configuration and not the default one present in the operating system. So by now it should be clearer what differentiates our solution from alternative implementation. If we want to summarize the big difference between all those alternatives that we put it a bit here in the list, and ours is the centralization of trust. If someone get their credential compromised by using these other services, for example, or the provider itself is compromised, you have basically lost everything. This can't happen in our case because of the obtain framework that it's really solved exactly this specific problem. In general, it's a choice between a circle of trust where you bring the device inside some kind of perimeter where you feel that you can have some kind of trust and security, or, for example, use our approach of zero trust model where you don't have to create any perimeter at all because every connection is authenticated and can be controlled by offline root of trust. There are obviously other technical differences, you know, involving, for example, the tunnel part technology, but our solution using SSH, you know, from our point of view, it's really efficient and secure. So this is why we decided to use it. And for our point of view, it's not really the most important challenge here. The most important challenge is the security part. Going ahead, our solution not only allow you to have access to a remote console, as maybe Lucas already mentioned, we can basically access whatever TCP service present in our devices using our secure SSH tunneling. For example, here I prepared a video. Let's see if we can run the video. Yeah, let's put full screen. So basically here, as you can see, there is on the left side, I am in my office here in Italy, and on the right side, in a moment, you should see my colleague Mateus from his Brazilian office with his device on the desk. So with our remote access solution, I have the ability to access his VNC server on his device and access the graphical part. So basically, I'm able to, you know, do operation on the graphical part. This is a very powerful feature, even if it's not really designed to work with applications that require a lot of bandwidth. We recommend using it, for example, only for temporary debugging session. Let's just skip a bit because the video is a bit long. Here, for example, after creating the tunnel, I am able to run the VNC viewer on my computer. And then this is the VNC windows. And let's skip a bit. Yes, here we can see side by side my remote VNC viewer. And on the right side, you can see the real device that is in Brazil. And basically, I'm able to perform some graphical operation. In this case, it's just a test. I open it like a terminal. And as you can see, the terminal opened also real time in Brazil. Yes, I can do some operation. Basically, the user can see. You can see what the user can see. So that's a very powerful feature, especially for debugging purpose. And yes, I think that's it for this. Just a note for this feature. Right now it's in beta status. That means it's already supported at architectural level. As you can see, you can actually use it. It's just missing the UI part that allows the user to use the feature in a kind of easy way. So, having said that, we are approaching to the end of the webinar. Let's see how you can start using this feature today. So the feature is supported on all our hardware and it's fully tested and integrated in our Torizon core operating system. That, just to remind you, is our custom Yocto distribution. If you don't have any hardware, you can use common Torizon images that is available for third-party hardware like Raspberry Pi, whatever generic x86 devices, even for QEMU, and you can find in our website the pre-built images. The feature is under commercial tier. So in our Torizon platform, if you don't have it, you need to request the 30-day trial to test it. All the other features that you saw during the webinar, such as OTA updates, device monitoring, the outlier, or whatever other things, it's available out of the box and do not require any commercial tier. Just a note, for customers that use offline scenario, remember that you can always provisioning a device and then maybe hibernate it and be ready to use it in the future in case you have a problem. Yes, here we leave some reference where you can learn more about the feature. There is our development website where we describe the functionality in detail. And there is also a link to the GitHub repository where you can find the source code of our remote access client. Because as you surely already know, all our device side software is released open source. So Torizon Core, the operating system, all the meta layer. And here you can even find the source code of the remote access client. Yeah, with this slide, we are approaching to the Q&A session. But first, let me introduce my colleague, John Oster, who works in the Torizon group as a Torizon platform product owner and security expert, who will help us answer your questions. So let's check what we have here in the list. Just a moment. Okay, maybe I already have some question for you, John. For example, for example, we can use yes, this one. Yeah, John, you should see the question.
Okay, that's a good one. And I think you touched on this a little bit during the presentation, but I think it's a really valid question. So someone asked, why not use a VPN? Isn't that simpler? Isn't it more straightforward? And I would say that you can. It's certainly a valid choice. I'm not going to knock that as a start of your architecture, but it's also not the end of the choices you need to make. Using a VPN, of course, you're gonna have that circle of trust model. You have to decide: do I want to use a VPN effectively as a tunnel? And if so, how do I want that tunnel to be alive all the time, or do I want to trigger the initiation of the tunnel in some way? And that is that infrastructure and that service, that's more attack surface for you to worry about, for one thing. And then depending on the VPN you choose, it's infrastructure to maintain. And I think it's also potentially a little bit dangerous in that VPN solutions, often you end up when you leverage that tool, you end up with this with the circle of trust model, where anything inside the VPN is treated as mostly trusted or authorized, and then that ends up, I think, being a little bit more of a target. So you can, but there are more things to set up. It's a bit of a target, and I should also mention perhaps that an always-on VPN, especially if you're on a metered connection on a modem or something, can really up your bandwidth usage significantly. Doable, but really only one part of the story. I would say that a VPN solution provides kind of the first half of what Stefano described in the architecture of the feature, where you establish the tunnel to your own backend. You still have to worry about how do I authenticate the actual remote sessions on the device? What is there going to be an SSH server running all the time? What am I going to do for the other half of things? I'm not sure who asked that, but hopefully that addressed most of your concerns.
Yes. I think yes. So let's go ahead. Maybe one for I don't know. Let's see.
I see one here I'd like to maybe answer. I see a question about firewall rules and ports. So you do certainly need to set up, if you're behind a very restrictive firewall, there is one port on the Torizon backend that you'll need to authorize outgoing TCP connections to establish the tunnel. But that's it, one port on one host, and that port will be consistent. The port that that you use as a user to connect to the device will change with each connection, but the port the device uses will always be the same for all devices across the fleet. So you can, you have a fairly simple firewall rule to set up.
John, there is also another interesting question. How is the SSH tunnel established between my host machine and the device?
Yeah, this is a really good and useful question. So what we do for our implementation, the device opens up an SSH session with our backend. And forwards a single port that is actually then publicly accessible. So this is where the zero trust model comes in. We don't authenticate you. You don't have to. We don't authenticate your public keys at the on the Torizon backend. So that port gets opened up, and the device spins up a new SSH server on that port with an extremely locked down configuration, and it only accepts the configuration is generated anew when the tunnel opens, and it only accepts the SSH keys that you have pre-authorized on the platform side, which again, this is the what you can optionally do using offline signing keys. So you have a pre-authorized list of keys that can be used. If you want to disable remote access, you can simply remove all of the authorized keys. That's basically it. Once you have that server running on the device accessible with the keys you've specified, then you have access to all of the features of SSH to use as you like. So that's how you saw in the VNC demo. It was using completely standard SSH-based port forwarding. Anything you can do with an SSH session, you can do with this remote access feature. That's also, I find, a strong benefit to the Zero Trust architecture. We get to use very familiar, standard, well-known tools in, I think, a very solid, hardened configuration that allows you a lot of flexibility. So especially when it comes to embedded use cases, we don't know in advance what exactly all of our customers are going to want to do. Yeah, we can show you a bunch of cool demos with VNC and open up a remote GDB session. There are all kinds of cool things we can do, but in the end, what we want to do is enable you to do the things that we haven't thought of yet as well. I hope that answers that one.
Yes, there is another one. Let me read. Is the remote access using an inbuilt SIEM, or how is the connection done with the via the customer network?
Yeah, so we don't offer inbuilt SIEMs with our modules today. You can, of course, build out a carrier board that adds that, but this is bring your own internet connection. So if your device or your design has a built-in SIM that can access the internet, again, you can whitelist that one specific host and port and allow the remote access client to operate on that. Or if it's a device that is network connected via Wi-Fi or wired network or anything like that, it's just a standard TCP connection over the internet.
Thank you. Let's go ahead. This one I can also answer by myself. what are minimum hardware required for Torizon Core? I mean, Torizon Core does not require heavy, you know, resources like a gigabyte of RAM. We support it in, even in our lowest end device that maybe it's, correct me if I'm wrong, Lucas, it's like the MX6 ULL and that has less than 1 gigabyte of RAM, maybe it's 512 or even 256, I don't know. But yeah, heavily depend on what you are going to do. Because if, for example, you need to do heavy things like a graphical application or whatever other complex things, maybe you need to move to a kind of different hardware, but not because of the resources that needs to write some code, because the resources that will need your application. The system itself is just a very minimal Yocto distribution with some nice tool configuration that we added from Toradex to, you know, provide you the nicest experience. And of course, all the tools that allow you to connect to our platform, like the Aptain client called Actualizer, the remote access client, the daemon for the device monitoring. And at the end, that's it. It's not nothing really complex. Let's go ahead with another question. What do I need to have on the device side to make it work? So on the device side, what you need is Torizon Core operating system. That is basically our Linux distribution that already includes our remote access client. Today, it's just needed to run the service. Lucas already showed it in a slide, but you can find the specific information and a step-by-step guide in our developer website on how to enable it and how to run your first, you know, remote access session. Yes, then you need some stuff on your host machine. What you need is just set up, generate an SSH key, configure your computer to work with this SSH key. Of course, you need an SSH client to be able to do to run the remote access session, but at the end, that's it. It's pretty standard. Nothing special, it's really required. It's out of the box in Linux, and now it's also out of the box in Windows, so nothing special is required. And that's it. Let's see another question.
I'll throw in just one added thing to that, which is, like you mentioned earlier, Stefano, the client is completely open source. So if you're feeling brave, you can also feel free to work out how to run it yourself on some arbitrary hardware. Of course, strongly recommend that you use Torizon Core, but you know, we are hacker friendly. If you want to try it out for yourself and dive into the source code, you're more than welcome to.
And John, this leads us to the next question. This is very connected to this topic because one guy in the audience asked, can I benefit from using Toradex remote access for non-Toradex devices? For example, do you provide the Yocto layer with your software to put into other device? Absolutely, yes. But not only the remote access feature. The Torizon core distribution, it's open source. You can find the reference in our GitHub repo. And basically, you can download it. And not only, we also support some 30-party hardware. As I said in one of my slides, we already support the generic ZX6, for example, QM ARM image. So if you have whatever other 30-party device, you can do very easily do a kind of porting. Also because there is it's not that complex because all those features are software, are not really connected to the hardware. So basically should work out of the box on whatever other hardware. I mean, it's not like depending on architecture or other things. So let's see. I mean, there is a question that, yeah, I can also answer this.
Oh, that traversal, absolutely. And so somebody in the audience asked, does this also work if the device is behind a NAT router? Yes. So we use a pretty standard tunneling approach here. So as long as the device is able to establish an outgoing connection to ras.torizon.io, then the remote session will work. There's no need to open a port specifically for the device. No particular issues with NAT or anything like that. Of course, I think we're well aware there. You will, in some industries and some situations, come across extremely aggressive firewalls behind multiple layers of NAT. And in some cases, you might need to like I mentioned before, make sure that the firewall allows an outgoing connection to this specific port on this specific host. But in general, it should work fairly seamlessly. I think that's about
John,
it.
Another interesting question for you. You should be able to read.
So I was wondering if somebody would ask this, since we mentioned, am I going to lose access to the device remotely in the event that an update crashes or it's hanging? And I think I see where this question is coming from, because we mentioned we bootstrap ourselves off of these roots of trust from the software update system. So yeah, it would be natural to think, well, does that mean that if I'm trying to troubleshoot a problematic update, then I'm not going to be able to use the remote access? No, that's not the case. We use the same root of trust, but the remote access client is a standalone client that independently processes all of those trust directives. Again, you can look at the source yourself. It's a I think quite straightforward to understand Rust program that performs all of the tunneling setup, spinning up the SSH server, and validating the obtained metadata and its signatures.
And since you just mentioned the obtained metadata, there is another question asked by the audience. Do you use the TAF framework, or this is completely different technology?
This is well spotted. So obtained is an extension of or expansion on the update framework that is designed, designed originally for automotive use cases specifically, and the difficulties and challenges there. Obtain builds on top of TUF. So if you're familiar with TUF, the update framework, it is a framework strictly for securing software repositories, think the Python package index or NPM or Ruby gems or repositories like that. Obtain extends that idea a little bit farther to also consider device management. So instead of just a repository that lists all of the valid targets for install or all of the valid packages available in the repository, Obtain specifies how do the edge devices communicate with the repository, and how are they directed to install specific software. And then it also includes quite a bit more than that. I'm not going to get into a whole Obtain presentation now, but the basic idea behind Obtain is that you can get secure cryptographically signed attestations of what software is installed on the device. So you get a signed manifest every time the device checks for updates, and you can action your installation of updates based on the contents of the manifest. So yes, we use the update framework. The update framework is essentially half of what Obtain is.
Thank you, John. There is also a question that maybe it's not 100% related to this topic, but I want to just spend 5 seconds to answer. The question is about, can updates be covered not only on Linux platform, but also on the smaller device running on microcontroller like Cortex-M? Let me spoiler you something. We are very, very, very close to release a nice feature that should exactly cover this use case, will be called subsystem updates, But for today, this is what I can say. So please stay tuned. This will be out very soon.
And you might not find that very surprising, given that we're using Uptane, which is designed for the automotive case, where you might have one or two primary central gateway ECUs in the vehicle, and then dozens more smaller microcontrollers that may need to be independently updated. So the base that we build on is really designed for that use case.
John, another question for you, if you can read it.
Can it be reasonable to have some predefined share keys so that for customers it might be easy to start from scratch and have a better out-of-the-box experience? That's an interesting question. I might ask
I don't know if it's about SSH. I don't know if it's about SSH key or, you know, the key for signing.
I would certainly not recommend sharing SSH keys even between individuals in the same company, and certainly never, you should never share SSH keys with your customers. And in general, I'll answer the question by saying that you certainly could do that. You can define, as Lucas showed in his demo, you can define the SSH keys that are permitted for a given Uptane repository, that are permitted for remote access for those devices. For example, if your customers have already communicated an SSH key to you, you can set up their repository for them and add that SSH key. That would certainly work. But in general, it's very much not a recommended practice to ever share private key materials. Personally, I use a different SSH private key on different devices, storing inside secure enclaves when possible.
Okay.
Not everybody is quite that extreme about it, but you generally shouldn't share a private keys.
Thank you so much, John. We have really a lot of questions. This is really positive, but we are over time, Toad. So we will answer just one more, and for the rest, we will be in touch via email. I added one for you, Lucas, if you can read. It's about, is there a minimum Torizon core version that I need to install to use the remote access feature?
Yes. So the remote access client that, as John mentioned, is open source, it's out there on GitHub. We merged that on our frequent Horizon Core builds, I believe on version 6.3. So from then on, you can use whatever version you want. If it's equal or higher than this one, the remote client should be there. The remote access client should be there.
Okay. Thank you so much. And this was the last question. So thank you so much, everyone, to be here, and see you in the next webinar. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks, everyone.